See, I'm a filmmaker basically, and I mean, she used to be more of a political thing. And she came into the field, actually, she's always been an English journalist, and she was working for Times of India, Sunday Magazine, Telegraph, and all that. So, I mean, it was more of a humanitarian journalism when she was there, when she was in that. And then when my father passed away in 2000, she came in and said, okay, we'll handle the Kannada newspaper. And she was not that good in it. I mean, she, of course, she would read and talk. But to write language was very important. My father was a huge guy whose language was very much appreciated and his literature value was very much appreciated. So she was very apprehensive in taking it up, you know. But then she said, okay, I'll give it a shot. And in the beginning, we remember when she would write in English and people would translate that for, you know, to the paper. And gradually, within 2 years, she reached such a point where she could correct her colleagues and even the proofreader and all that. She would correct the spellings of that. So that much interest she took and all that. But during the course of the time, around 4 or 5 years into the line, she got into a lot of activism and active journalism. So that part which we were not very aware of, though we knew what she was going, she was going to Baba Budangiri to solve that problem, you know, to go to tribals, like very recently she went to was the Didali, Didali tribals were being dislocated. So all these kind of fights she's been having, in, you know, with, against a lot of, especially anti-establishment kind of thing. And in between the Naxalites, for instance, I mean, the people are so, the social media and the people now, they just read the headline and make up whatever, you know, they don't read, go into the in-depth of the story. So actually she was accused of being a Naxalite herself, or an urban Naxalite, which was so untrue. What she did was actually, she was not only her, it was a forum where including a 100-year-old freedom fighter is there, Devnur Mahadev, who is a fantastic writer and a very well-respected writer of Kannada, is there. So all these people made a forum. And they were in talks with the Naxalites to leave their arms and come into the mainstream society, which is not Naxalism. But people, including after she passed away, if you see the trolls and things like that, she was a Naxalite. So, I mean, it's so, they don't go into any in-depth. When she was fighting for the minority, when she was fighting for the Christians, the Muslims, the Dalits. So everything, she was pro the, you know, she was the one, put it in one word, she was the voice for the voiceless. So that is what she stood for, I think. And though she's been silenced now, what I feel is, after she's passed away, so many people are like translating on their own and putting it to the social media. Now Nayana publishers have come from Kerala to saying they're published in English. And now the Telugu, they're releasing it in Telugu, the book of which was done by Chandan Goda, a good friend of us and a journalist as well, our columnist as well. So people are, it's being translated to so many languages. I think many, many Gauris will be born because of this. More than just silencing her, the opposite has in fact happened and should happen, I think, if it has not happened. That people will stand up for their rights. They're not going to say, okay, it's one language, India is known for its beauty and it's because of its diversity. You know, everybody could coexist without harming to this level. So I think, that's the positive thing which has happened, I think. See, the follow-up of the case has been a lot of speculation in the media. I mean, every day is something new coming from that, but I am not trusting that because it seems it becomes like a circus, you know. So I'm just listening to what the SIT team is telling us. And we have high optimism in them because they have the largest number of people they have put and also the kind of work they have done. Most effort, I believe, they're putting in. So I trust that they'll come out soon with and solve the case, which I met Mr. B.K. Singh recently. And they have said that there's vital clues they have got, but to close in, they need some more evidence. So I'm hoping they'll do a good job. Basically, I'm a filmmaker. I used to be a documentary filmmaker earlier, and then I gradually came into feature films. And I've made about 10 feature films. One recently I'm making one is in English and Kannada. It's a bilingual. And a couple of national awards, one international. I feel very bad saying all this in this moment. If you put this separately, it's fine. Because it's more important about my sister right now, and I'm not the type to gloat about myself. And more than that, filmmaking is for me a passion. So I'm not really looking at it as commercial value that way. Of course, it has made its money. But at the same time, I want to say something to it. In fact, my last film was about a little Dalit boy and the untouchability. My first film was about politics and how the, you know, Nandita Das had acted in it. So different. As people say, I can't really make a movie with only magic and no logic. I'm very sensible that way. Right now I'm working on a children's film called Summer Holidays. which in fact Gauri acted in it, small role as an activist, and yeah, so that's about it. Yeah, it's called Azad. Apparently he's Meera Nair's associate or something. It's a beautiful film actually. It's a short film about somebody like Gauri fighting for the minorities, and he's actually in the daytime he's working in a factory kind of thing, and in the night he's writing poetry and articles, and his son doesn't believe in him because they're living in a very small lower middle class kind of place. So he says, what is this writing about? You know, we used to say the same thing about Gauri, for instance. What are you doing? You haven't made a site. Even the house she was living in, my mother had made, office I had fought for, you know, and partitioned it for me and her and my brother. So she's not really bought anything for herself. But then when she passed away, I realized the kind of people she's garnered and the kind of response she's been getting now all over the country. People are protesting about the killing. So I'm proud of her that way. So this movie is the same thing. The son and the father don't understand each other, or at least don't believe in their ideologies. I believed in my sister's idea, but I said, why do you have to be so much fighting there, you know? But we need that. There's something called self-censorship. Why should you have self-censorship, you know? There should be a decorum in what you say, that's fine. But if you're going to say, you can't speak against the government, you should censor yourself. Why should you do that? So what is freedom of speech in that case, such a democratic society? So that's what this film talked about. And finally the father is found dead, and the son then he understands what his father stood for, you know. So then he starts writing in his father's memory. So it's a very close, very much to what has happened. It's a smaller version of Gauri's. In fact, one person called Deepu has made a documentary for 1 hour called I Am Gauri, and it's all on YouTube and all that. It's a fantastic one. Yeah. So in fact, he has so much more footage, so he wants to make a longer version later. This was just a tribute to her kind of thing.